our country, we will go into the details. We have eminent personalities who will be sharing with us. But one small story I would like to tell is that in our place we have a story that one person was going for hunting rabbits. He went into the jungle, started digging the burrows, and the rabbits started running. Then only he realized that he did not bring the dogs. So he was searching for the dogs. And that is how today we are searching for the infrastructure. And from the four goals which was announced on November 8th, government switched over to a new goal. Initially they started talking about cashless economy. Now they are talking about less cash economy. Now, one background which I have read about this less cash economy is a report of the Boston Consultancy Group titled Digital Banking 2020, in which very blatantly, very openly they are saying that you have to force people to switch over to a digital India, towards a cashless economy. Unless you do that, people like Reliance, people like Airtel, Vodafone, Paytm, who have been given the license for a payment bank, they will not be able to get adequate income. So now you can understand what is the real goal of the government in bringing in this digital economy or the cashless economy. Here, just one point I would like to add, and I will call the resource person. Today in our country, 26% of the people are illiterate. They cannot read and write. Government's own statistics says that only 10% of the population can read and write English to some extent. And among the younger generation, out of the children who are eligible to be in this school system, there are 8 crore 43 lakh children who are out of the school system because they are not able to afford education. And only 10% of the rural children who pass out in plus two, they have access to higher education because of a huge cost in higher education. Now, but whatever technology today available, that technology is all based on English. A very little bit of Hindi software is available for mobile banking and other things. So we have a big challenge in the field of digital infrastructure if we have to cater to a huge population. And we do not once again bring in a bigger divide between the haves and have-nots. The digital infrastructure has to improve. So with this in mind, I will request first Professor Govinda to make his presentation. Due to paucity of time, I request him that please restrict your presentation to 10 to 15 minutes. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me at the outset thank the organizers for inviting me. I didn't realize that in a conference on digital matters, one will be so informal. So possibly I'm the most dressed man here. So my apologies for that. Now, the chairman mentioned about the November 8th decision. Some have hailed it as historic and unprecedented, and some others have said that this is a mammoth tragedy and organized group. Now, there have been lots of narratives. There have been lots of discussions on this issue. In fact, the newspapers have been full of, sort of things they continue to be, and then people have been suffering. People have been standing in the queues, often standing in front of empty ATMs and then empty banks. So the Prime Minister, in the first narrative, the Prime Minister said, the objectives of this particular thing is, I quote, enemies across the border are using fake currency notes. So that's the first objective, to deal with the enemies across the border. And you know, that raises your patriotism. Then he said, you have to break the grip of corruption in that corner. Now, as the time went about, the narrative started changing. In an economy with 97% of the transactions are cash-based, rendering 86% of the currency has brought about unprecedented hardships. Yet people are willing to put up with the sufferings because with the hope that, oh, that fellow is going to be caught and therefore I am willing to suffer. That's been the you know, they were hoping that the corrupt will get penalized. But as the time went and then when most of the people started putting the money back in the system and, you know, sort of then they were existing, so the narrative started changing. Now they say, oh, now we want the cashless economy. And, you know, the objective of the entire exercise has changed. You know, there is a small story I want to tell, which everybody in the primary school must have heard. This is about a Tokuwala who was, selling topis and then coming and one day, hot afternoon, was resting under a tree and the bunch of topis that he had, the monkeys came and, you know, monkeys in the tree came and they took it away and put it on. So when he got up, he saw that the topis were in there, and then suddenly he realized that, oh, monkeys took it, so took out his topi and took it down. All the monkeys put the topi down. His son continued the job. The narrative didn't stop here. His son continued the job. And his grandson also did the same job. And when his grandson also was going, and he met in the same place. I mean, he was sleeping under a tree and then the monkeys took the topi. So he suddenly remembered what his grandmother told and then he put the topi down, but the monkeys didn't put the topi down. The big monkey came down, slapped him on the face and said that, you mean to say that only your grandfather will tell you what to do? You know, in game theory we call it theory of repeated games. Basically, what I am trying to say is that people adjust to the new circumstances. When you have the black money, the people who generate black money will find new ways to find, you know, they have new ways of storing wealth. But the question is not even that, the question is further. Is this an appropriate policy instrument for the objective that is taken? Do the institutions in India have the capacity to cope with the problem, particularly the Reserve Bank of India? How long will it take to demonetize? And what are the short and long-term implications? Now let us understand the following. In fact, in 1963, Justice Bhagwati and Ramaswamy wrote a beautiful article in American Economic Review. And an important, you know, sort of message from the article was that an optimal instrument is the one which attacks the source of the distortion. This instrument should attack the source of the distortion. The question is, does demonetization attack the source of the distortion? So from that sense, Bhagavati Ramaswamy test fails. Of course, it's a different thing that Bhagavati has gone about praising Modi for this particular act. That's a different issue, but he was contradicting himself in this. Not all black money is in cash and not all cash is black money. So demonetization is neither necessary nor a sufficient condition for dealing with black incomes or wealth. It does not deal with the process of generating black money. I'll tell you what the processes are. There is no impact on, it doesn't have an impact on the incentive to generate black money. There is little impact on the stock of the black economy. Because, the estimate, in fact, that the white paper in the Ministry of Finance based on the search and seizure operations of the Income Tax Department, which says that the amount of cash held in the, between 1966 between 1996 and 2012, the amount of cash held is somewhere about 3.8 to 7%, you know, in search and seizure operations. So by and large, what you will see is that if you have a huge black wealth, about 5% of that is held in cash. The rest of it is held in either real estate, foreign exchange, put somewhere else, buildings, etc. So now what has happened is that initially we were told that something like 14.4 trillion rupees were the currency. But later on the narrative came and it says, now they say they'll be 15.4 trillion. That is 15.4 lakh crore. Overwhelming proportion of that seems to have come back. And obviously, my good friend Urjit Patel is not able to tell the people how much actually come back. Maybe the entire money has come back, and that may be the reason why he is not able to tell, and he says that they are reconciling it. So if the entire thing has come back, then obviously, you know, the way to catch your black, you know, wealth has not happened. You know, that's where the problem is. Of course, there have been lots of stories about round tripping, surrogate deposits, laundering through the northeastern route, advance payments, etc., etc. I mean, that is how, you know, we go back to that monkey story that I mentioned earlier. Is the black economy distinct? It's a part and parcel of the whole economy. Black becomes white becomes black, as you go on transacting. So in a black money fellow, if he starts playing, the cash is becomes white. Or if you start saying that this is an agricultural income, it becomes white. You don't even have to pay the taxes. Whereas in an economy where the entire agricultural income is not taxed, it's easy to sort of misclassify. And not one, you know, anybody with an agricultural, huge non-agricultural income having an agricultural income will always say that it is non-agricultural income. And then they said that, oh, no, you don't understand this. Demonetization is only a start. There will be many more measures that will be taken. Why do you have to take the many more measures first? Why do you have to put all these people into such a large difficulty? Why do you have to take the many more measures that, you know, what are those measures, first of all? And why, are they dependent upon demonetization? In fact, if you really look at it, you know, you might reduce a lot of black economy in real estate by reducing the stamp duties and getting rid of the capital gains tax. But that has nothing to do with the demonetization. Now, about bureaucratic action, there are a variety of things. You see, political funding. Have you done anything? Now, the Prime Minister is saying that let us develop a consensus. Did he develop a consensus before demonetization? Why? What is the problem? Let BJP come up and say that we are going to put our books for general audit. We are going to subject ourselves to Right to Information Act. We will tell the people what the sources of funding are. Let them say it, and then obviously there is a lot of moral pressure on others to do it. Why are they not doing it? Then he wants consensus. And tax evasion. Bureaucratic corruption. Bureaucratic corruption happens because bureaucrat has a power. Either power to endow something to you or power to, you know, sort of reduce your punishment. And, you know, so there is what we call in economics an oligopolistic power, and he has obviously made. In fact, this is not new. In fact, Kautilya, writing way back, said about the bureaucratic corruption, he said, just as it is impossible not to taste honey or poison that one may find at the tip of one's tongue, so it is impossible for one dealing with the government funds not to taste at least a little bit of king's wealth. So obviously, people have been eating king's wealth, but in this particular place, people have been taking, you know, eating people's wealth anyway. Is the government serious about ending black economy? Then, you know, obviously you should start with political funding. You know, the election commission has put ceiling on expenditures. For political parties, you know, 75 lakh for parliament seat and 28 lakh for MLA seat. But actual spending in 2014 elections, as against what is reported as 7,000 crore, was actually 30,000 crore, and it was Hindu which basically, you know, did the survey and got it. Now there is this big story. In fact, when I was talking about, NITI was asked to look at this thing on the reform of the medical council, the whole issue of regulating medical thing. I was talking to a senior functionary. I said, look, I mean, you guys have to do it. Most of the MPs are involved in this. Medical council is one of the most corrupt organizations. That's what the police says. 82 MPs have medical colleges. Now, I don't have to say anything more than that. You know, the previous government was forced to appoint 3 institutions to do a major study on black economy. National Council of Applied Economic Research, National Institute of Financial Management, and National Institute of Public Financial Policy. In fact, I was the director of NIPFP, so I instituted the study there. Now, they adopted a variety of approaches. I don't know for what of time I will not go into. Now, the basic point is the size of the black economy varies very widely, depending upon what assumptions you do. But let me, the interesting part is these institutions have been begging the government, please let us make these reports public. Government has not given them the permission to make these reports public. So they are constrained. You know, I have a copy of the NIPFP report because I was a director. That's a different issue. The World Bank estimates that we have our black economy is 20.6%, which is equal to that, which is similar to Israel. McKinsey report says we have 26%. Now, there is a credit study which says that the wealth in the country is double that of the income in the country. 2 times. Which basically means our total wealth comes to some, if it is 26%, our total black wealth, 26% is the black economy, black wealth is somewhere about 52%. Demonetized currency of 15.4 trillion comes to something like a 20% of GDP. Or 40% of the black wealth that we have, or 25% of 40% of the black income that we have, 25% of the black wealth. If 10% does not return in this of the money they save, we have basically something like 2.5% of the black income or 1.3% of the black wealth. I just wanted to tell you what exactly we have done by doing this brahmastra. What have you really achieved? How long will it take to demonetize? Let us say that we don't need 15.4 trillion, let us take 12 trillion. Much less. We will manage with that. Rest of it will be taken care of by my friends, digital friends. Optimistic estimate that it will take about 140 days. Of course, suffering at the length of the fuse will abate. And somebody said that when the Prime Minister asked for 50 days, he was saying that the maximum suffering is on 50 days and thereafter it will start coming down. The actual currency requirement will be more as the people tend to hold money now. One of the things that has happened is that you ask everyone, are we keeping the amount of money that we have at home, the amount of money that we actually require? We are keeping much more because of the precautionary motive, because we don't know what happens tomorrow. Every one of us is increasing, putting something like 3 to 4 times more currency in our house than what we really need. Well, after some time things will stabilize, but the short and long term impact is that informal sector's contribution in this country is 80% of employment and 45% of GDP. There has been huge loss of employment and production. There has been a compression in consumption, particularly purchases from informal economy. Now, when you say that part of the wealth doesn't come back, if the part of the wealth doesn't come back, now there is something called wealth effect, which is supposed to reduce consumption. But unfortunately, much of it has come back. But then, there can be, greater taxes. In fact, the taxpayer, tax collector will be looking at all the major accounts now. There will be a lot more of interesting news that will come in the next 1 year. Interesting, quote unquote, as you see. Long term, obviously, overall consumption has depressed, but but then, in fact, over a period of time, this can pick up as the remonetization takes place. But there have been long-term effects. I mean, one doesn't know as yet. You will see that quite a lot of the medium and small scale industry has been virtually shut down. And, many of them, whether they will be able to come back into the stream, which has entire B1T power loom sector has, in fact, is completely vanished in the stream. There are leather industries, there are quite a number of these informal sector industries which have been in a bad shape. In fact, as it is, economy has been decelerating. As compared to last year, where the economy had grown at 7.6% GDP, this year the growth, estimated growth without taking into account for demonetization is 7.1. Except for public administration and agriculture, every other sector has decelerated in the country. Now, there has been major deceleration in particularly manufacturing, which was 7.4 from 9.3, mining and quarry, construction. I'll stop. I'll take 2 more minutes. So you have a situation where most of these sectors have been slowing down. And in that particular environment, you have a demonetization shock, which is going to overall, the estimate is that, in fact, IMF estimates that the growth rate for 2017-18 will be somewhere about 6%. Of course, there are others who say 6.5, but then from 7.5, certainly I don't think we can now, after this, we'll boast that it will be the fastest growing economy. Other implications, there are gains from not depositing the cash, but then that has not happened. There can be, there will be some digitization surely, but whether that will take care of our problems, we don't know. Whether people will return to the use of cash over a period of time, we don't know, we'll have to see. And so I don't want to, because that's something which is speculative. So the last part is, why do we go from here? Obviously, remonetization is taking place. There will be a whole lot of, in fact, there's a clear loss of credibility in the system. That's the one which is a major concern. So we will have to facilitate digitization. My friends will do a lot of good there. They will help in doing that. And let us hope that they will embark on some cleaning up for the political funding. But most importantly, we do need lots of policies to clean up the administrative issue. And there are lots of administrative reforms that are called for. But in the meantime, we will continue to appreciate the Prime Minister for the war that we are waging demonetization against black belt, and still the black belt will continue. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. He has given a whole summary of what is happening with the demonetization and has stamped it that it was not necessary at all. And a very nice point he made is that people adjust to the situation, and being a lot of students sitting here and I being a correspondent of an institution, SUOA Educational Trust, I would like to share with you how people are adjusting. You know that educational institutions are the ones who collect quite a lot of money and keep it black. And one of the correspondents told me that for a medical seat I was taking 60 lakhs. Now I will increase it to 1 crore. Now I will start giving receipts like Vellore Institute of Technology is giving receipts. Every year I will say that it is 25 lakh fee. So I get 1 crore, I will also pay the tax, still I will get something extra. So that is how people adjust. Now I request Sri Sharad Sharma to share with you his idea.
How many of you are students there? I was a student like you way back in 1986, and what had happened was, just a few years earlier in 1979, George Fernandez had done a dhamaka of a similar kind and had pushed the multinational IT companies out of India. You know, and it was very hard to fathom what will happen. It wasn't very clear in those days, what would actually manifest. But I was actually a big beneficiary. I think I'm standing in front of you because of that dhamaka. So I set out to do my electrical engineering, but I got interested in Unix. And I became essentially a Unix kernel coder. At that time, the word hacker was not so common. I actually started off in my college with CPM before I got to Unix. But you know what happened was that since the multinationals couldn't come into India, there were a number of Indian companies that were essentially taking Unix as the source license, porting it on Intel 386 processors and selling that as server here in India. And you know, way back in 87, 88, 89, India had the largest number of Unix source licenses outside the US. There were 9 companies in India who had paid for a Unix source license. And that became a thriving industry. So when in 92, the barriers started coming down, many of those companies turned this into R&D for hire. And many of you may not even know that the company that benefited most from this Unix growth in the commercial ecosystem was a company called Veritas in Silicon Valley. Right? Many of you may know that. And you know, Veritas established its R&D center in Pune in 92. And in 2006, 54% of Veritas patents came from Pune. Worldwide patents came from Pune. Because the Unix kernel core had got created in India. And that, in several ways, accounts for the IT services industry, IT industry that we have today. I am sure Mr. George Fernandez had no clue this is going to happen. And I'm sure he didn't, because, had he not done that, I would have probably been selling detergent. I would have gone and done my MBA and something like that, right? So I don't know what the impact of demonetization will be 5 or 10 years from now. I really don't. But I want to make 2 points. The point that I want to make is that we as human beings are not wired to understand nonlinear change. We don't know how change happens. So I ended up being part of this AT&T Bell Labs family. I kind of quit that, did a startup. That startup became part of Cisco. And at that time in 2004, I decided to abandon this world of telecom. But I was a very loyal Ma Bell kind of a guy, because I lived in that system for a number of years. Remember, Unix used to be owned by AT&T at one time. I was a very loyal Ma Bell person. So if you came to me in 2004 and you asked me that 10 years from 2004, AT&T, your old mothership, will not be the leader in carrying paid international voice minutes in the world, I would have laughed at you. I would have said, how is it possible? Who's going to take its place? British Telecom, Hong Kong Telecom, China Telecom, nobody can take its place. Right? And remember, international voice minutes, paid in voice minutes is a highly regulated industry. Highly regulated. You have to sign bilateral agreements and all of that to make that happen. Yet in 2009, AT&T was humbled. 5 years later, not even 10, 5 years later, was humbled and was no longer the largest carrier of paid international voice minutes in the world. Can any one of you guess who humbled AT&T in 5 years? Skype. Skype was born in August of 2004. In 5 years, it humbled that company. It was born in a country called Estonia of a population of 3 million people. You live in Chennai, that's a small part of Chennai. So sitting, and if you ask me where to put my finger on Estonia in 2004, I would have said it's one of these countries, but I don't know which exact one it is. Yet that small little company transformed international voice calling in a regulated industry. 5 years. If you told in 2010 all the mobile operators that they will completely see a wipeout of their SMS revenue in 3 years, how many of you do you think they would have believed this? Regulated industry, license. How many of them would have believed this? Yet in 2013, they were wiped out. Today, their ability, how many of you here do not use a WhatsApp? Is there anybody here in this room who doesn't use a WhatsApp? I see four hands, three hands going up here. Right? 2009, the company was formed only in 2009. So I think we forget that TV in India came in 1965. But when satellite TV came in 1985, in first 2 years alone, we doubled the number of TV sets that were there. In 5 years, we had covered a very large proportion of the Indian population. This is what happened with mobile phones. I think we have found a movement that has going to happen again. I don't know whether demonetization will help it or hurt it, I don't know. But what I want to tell you today is that there is, independent of demonetization, independent of that, there is something that is happening today that I want you to appreciate. And that something is called UPI. How many of you know about Internet 404 error? I want you to go and do your homework and go and look for Internet 402 error. 402 error exists, it's not used. It was set in place in 1982 because at that time the vision was that we should be able to send money to anybody else the way we are able to send email to anybody else. If I know your email address, I can send an email to you. I can send that email from any email system that I want. And I know that email will reach you. That is the SMTP email system that exists. There was a visualization that was there that you will one day be able to do that for money, the what you are able to do that with email. And that system does not exist anywhere else in the world but here in India. And that system in India is called UPI. If you know, you can take a UPI virtual payment address, you can have as many addresses, you can go to one bank and have four addresses, you can go to all your banks and have as many addresses. And I don't need to know anything about which bank you are with. I just need to know your VPA, your virtual payment address, and send you money and the money will reach you. It will reach you instantly and it is guaranteed to reach you. And I can send that money from my bank account using any of the 36 apps that are there. Total number of apps that have applied to have a license or to make an app available, banks that have is 160 banks. So you have 130 more apps that will come. I can use any of those apps. I don't need any permission from any bank to be able to do that. This system does not exist anywhere else in the world. On December 15th, we use, because of demonetization, people are using digital currency more. On December 15th, we saw 18 million debit card transactions happen. Total money that flowed was 2,700 crores. Average value, 1,300 rupees. But also on December 13th, we saw 6 million Paytm UPI transactions happen, 6 million. And those 6 million have grown by 32% by January 30th, by volume and 22% by value. Now, I don't know when the cash comes back to the system, will people stop using Paytm and UPI and all of this? They might. But I would like to tell you that the fact that you will move to a digital currency is not to do with the unavailability of cash. It is to do with a completely different cycle which is not estimated, what is not often understood in India. And that is to do with credit. Many of you who are going to pass out this year and get a job, you will earn more than 5 lakh rupees right from the beginning. You will be in what is called as India 1. India 1, believe it or not, you will be one of 50 million families, only 50 million families in India, which have an earnings, annual household income of more than $7,400 a year, which is about 5 lakhs, a little over 5. Between that income and $3,300 annual household income are 100 million families. Of that 100 million families, various estimates show that only 1%, if at all 1%, has ever received any form of bank credit. What do? They are the drivers, they are the street vendors, they are the micro businessmen. They don't get any bank credit. We nationalize banks thinking that will lead to financial inclusion. Do you think that has happened? Do you think that has gone to the next 100 million families that we are talking about? Of course it hasn't. So I think, the reality is that today the driver who brought me here in the car, when he starts working for Ola or Uber, he gets a loan. A small merchant, when he starts selling on Flipkart and Amazon, he gets a loan. Why? Because he is able to send the lender an NBFC most of the time, not a bank, what is called as his earnings for the last 1 month or 2 months. And the other person says, I know what you earned in the last 2 months, I'll give you a 1 month loan, 1 month loan, just 1 month loan. And if your earning in that month is the same that it was, I will rotate the loan and give you one more day. And we know that this factor, this ability to get flow-based credit as it is called, because the Indian banking system unfortunately only gives you collateral-based credit. It only gives you asset-based credit. This flow-based credit that we are talking about is, the myth is that this is misused. It is not misused. People use it. How do we know that? Because we know that from microfinance. We know that from what has happened in M-Paisa in Kenya. We know that the people actually invest that money, that small loan, that small credit that they're able to get. They invest it in their business, they invest it in their children's education, and they invest in their health. Because health is the biggest reason why they fall down from the middle India, 100 million families, to the strugglers below the poverty line. They know that. They use it. So which is why don't be surprised. When the merchant, when all this cash comes back into the system, the merchant comes back to you, and you are paying something to the panwala, and the panwala says, sir, madam, I would prefer you pay me on digital cash. Because all that he's trying to do is to make sure that he can get that flow-based credit from an NBFC or a bank at a rate that is one-fifth, one-tenth of what he gets from the money lender today. You know, the minimum money lender fee is 1% a day, 365% a year. Because this market is completely underserved. So those of us who live in ivory towers don't understand this at all. But what technology is enabling today is that these small merchants are the biggest advocates of this. Did anybody of you meet Paytm and Paytm came to you and said, come on, use this opportunity to go digital? No. What did it do? It went to small merchants, 6 million of them, and signed them up. They didn't do consumer, they said consumers will come, because if the merchant says pay digital, you'll pay digital, the won't you? So the people who need this is the small underserved merchant, who our banking system for the last 70 years has systematically ignored, despite all protestations to the contrary. I don't know whether demonetization will help or not. To me, I woke up a few days ago, you know, I was in Silicon Valley end of November, early December. I wake up in the morning and the first thing I see is some congratulations, Sharad, whatever. I'm very confused. I look on search and I see I've been appointed on this digital payments committee. I don't like to be on government committees, I'm telling you. I generally avoid it. So I look at my phone, I have this call from Mr. Amitabh. So I call him. I say, what is this, Mr. Amitabh? Why are you? He said, look, you know, you should have taken my permission. I asked him that. And he says, look, Sharad, you remember when the startup policy was launched, there was this Vigyan Bhavan panel discussion. You were moderating that panel discussion and you talked about India will go cashless in 4 years. At that day, you gave me the permission to be on that panel. But I said this was not based on cash becoming the constraint. It was based on credit being the killer app for actually people going cashless. So I really don't know whether cash is going to make any difference in the long run or not. I don't know whether demonetization will have the intended benefit or not. But I am in favor of shaking up the system. I am against us believing that if we let things go the way they are, somehow our health inclusion will happen. It hasn't happened for 70 years, for heaven's sake. I am not in favor of us believing, saying somehow if we let the system work the way it is, somehow primary education will be solved. It's not been solved for 70 years. So am I a champion of 8-step, a small NGO which says, in 10 years I will solve primary education, but I will use technology to make that happen. I don't know whether they will succeed, but I am really, really rooting for them to succeed, because I know the old method does not work. And if you as young people are not willing to embrace technology to solve India's hard problem, if you cannot embrace technology to solve India's hard problems, if you are a victim of the old way of doing things and continuing to do this the old way, which we know is not going to work for another 70 years, shame on you. So don't
says, India cannot change quickly. India can change quickly. And you know what will change it? It is you and me as engineers. We have let the economists have their say. We have let the bureaucrats have their say. It is time for us technologists to show India that with technology we will solve India's hard problems and take it to what it deserves to be. Thank you so much.
Thank you for that emotional speech. Well, when mobile was introduced in the country, you didn't have to force people to go and buy a mobile. Everybody has got a mobile. But why people have to be forced to go towards a cashless economy, I still have doubt. Mr. Sharad Sharma was talking about the asset-backed loans given by the banks. Being a banker, I would like to share with you, sir. For the corporate loans, there is no asset backing. It is only papers. It is only the small credit which is not available after the 1991 LPG. You look at before 1991 and after 1991, the type of credit given to different sectors, that will show you where it has gone and where the NPA is mounting. Yes, we have to face change. Change will take place, as he was mentioning, that without our knowledge, continuously change takes place. But change has to be for the better. We do not have money from the government to provide 3% of our GDP for education, but we are willing to spend any amount for a technology to benefit few rich corporates. This is something we question. As a trade unionist, I question. Now I request Sri Srikanth Lakshmanan to please come and share his view.
Hello everyone, I am Srikanth Lakshmanan. I also work on a lot of these cashless systems. So to give an overview, I am not going to speak much about demonetization. I am going to speak only about cashless systems and how we as consumers and citizens can gain more out of these cashless systems. Now, Sharad was telling how he was personally benefited by one such example in 1970s when there's an announcement from the ministry happened. Now I am wondering if youngsters, including me, and a lot of students here, can have a similar moment where we regain some of the rights or gain some of the rights that we never had through cashless systems. So I am pro cashless systems. But there are need to be some checks and balances that needs to be done on the way while we are building these cashless systems. I'm just waiting for a minute for the slide to come up. Meanwhile, I'll give a general disclaimer. None of the opinions expressed by me are associated with any of the entities that I associate with. All my opinions are purely personal. I might take an example of a few names, but those are only for representational purpose. And please do fact check whatever I'm saying, don't just believe me. After all, I'm a blogger, you should do a fact check of whatever I'm saying. And I'll just quickly wait. Seems to be some problem in coordinating, sorry. I'll still be doing that. And another disclaimer is I'm a free software user, so there could be some natural biases in terms of supporting costs. And the other errata is I'm no technical or policy expert. I'm just an average software engineer. Okay. So as I said, nothing on demonetization. I'll broadly cover what is the digital infrastructure part, and I'll also speak few words about what I call as a fat digital India. So there are also then new age digital problems, and what's the way forward, right? So on the digital infrastructure, there are different kinds of infrastructure that is required for a fully digital or cashless system, right? There are technical infrastructure, regulatory infrastructure, and what I call as availability infrastructure, and there is also an economic aspect to this digital infrastructure. So on the technical infrastructure or the basic infrastructure that's required for cashless or digital systems, one of the basic things that we need to have is power and network. We are improving a lot of, and government is probably investing a lot into these sectors. But there needs to be much more progress made on that front before we can actually fully go cashless. We are probably not there right there yet. And even on that, even in a city like Chennai, when a cyclone like Varda hits, we don't have the infrastructure. So that is something that needs to develop. But that's one aspect. And more specifically on the payment infrastructure, we all know there is only that much amount of ATMs and that much amount of POS machines. There's a reason for that, and those reasons include a variety of factors, which include some part of that blame goes to the bank, some part of the blame goes to the government, some part of the blame goes to the citizens, and but there's no point in blaming each other. We need to see how we fix it. Then there is another aspect called as skill capability across the spectrum, right? So we also need high technology skills, and trust me when I'm saying this, we are no less superpower than the Americans and the Europeans. So we do have the technical capabilities to do these cashless and digital infrastructure, but there is one small problem there, that the quality of the technical capabilities needs to increase across the board, and that is possible only through increased education, both within the government, within the academia, within the engineering and technology folks. So that is one aspect, and then there is then there is regulatory and legal infrastructure support that we lack today. So payments are yet to be regulated. So there is some action by the government in this point. They are trying to come up with a payments regulator. So the problem why payments need to be regulated is, as a consumer, right now if I try to make an electronic payment and if it fails, I need to speak to the customer care and I need to make sure that my money gets back to me, and that's a lot of hassle. And that is the way it is because there is no regulator out there. But I think that is something that needs to be fixed, and government is pursuing ways to fix that. And there's also a cost in the legal, there's a legal infrastructure that we lack. So let's assume that some company gives you a cashless product and you lose money, right? And what's the worst? I mean, even if you go to the regulators and the regulators fail you, your only recourse is to do a legal filing a suit against the company, right? Now, in India, we all know how courts work, so the legal infrastructure is just not there to support these systems. And more from a technology perspective, our ID Act is insufficient for the data protection requirements that we need for fully cashless and digital societies. And there is also an important point that's pending in courts today, like that's on privacy. So our courts are yet to agree whether we even have something called as right to privacy. So moving on to cashless systems, with these things unresolved, moving into a fully cashless things is probably dangerous. And I think everyone here, including Sharad, believes that these things are to be solved, and we all are doing our bits to solve these problems. And the next thing, as I call it, is availability problems. The first and foremost point in this I would like to tackle is internet shutdowns. Now, we could move into a digital economy, but we also have no regulation, no law on what we call as internet shutdowns. Internets are being shut down for silly reasons, like there's an exam going on and people need to, should not copy, to reasons like political tensions in Northeast and Jammu and Kashmir. So, and India has the highest number of internet shutdowns anywhere in the world, 38 times internet switch was switched off at a particular region. Now, we can't go into a digital society when we can have internet shutdowns. And then there is this internet infrastructure and availability. I agree with, we have come a long way in adoption of technology. Data is getting diversified across India. You have people in rural having access to internet, but that's, there still needs to be a lot of improvement on that front. And then there is language and literacy barriers. Now, most of these digital technologies are still being developed in English, but there is an important need for these technologies to translate and speak to the language of the people across India. And in some cases, we need to figure out and innovate solutions which cuts across literacy barriers as well. And then there is a whole concept of user acceptance, whether the user wants to do this. Yeah. And there's also an economic side of it. There is a cost to cashless. In the push to the cashless systems, a lot of the reports, government reports, suggest that there is a cost of cash to the economy. What it counts is, it counts the cost of cash to the formal economy, that is really banks, business, industries, people, most people in this room who are part of the formal economy. What it doesn't count is the cost of cash for the people who are outside this formal economy. Now, when we take decisions on whether to promote cashless or go fully cashless, it's very important to have very fair data on cost of cash and cost of cashless. And one point I'd like to note on here is the cost of cashless data, that all our reports lead to data that's being researched by the cashless industry, so there's an apparent conflict of interest. So that needs to be figured out. And then there is a notion of, are we ready to pay more? Yes, some of us in this room, including myself, I am ready to pay for some amount of convenience, but that should still be, that should always be an optional. So if I am accepting that as a convenience, I should be asked to pay more, but it should not be pressed upon. So then I will come to what is called as FAT Digital India. So there is this whole notion of FAT ML in the US, where they are trying to figure out these three components of ethics, that include fairness, accountability, and transparency in machine learning systems. Now, let's not go to machine learning systems, but we now have systems and apps that are out there that ask us to make transfers and give us check. But are these systems and technologies fair? Are they accountable? And are they transparent? Now, this is very important for a user to have these fair, accountable, and transparent systems. One of the things I would like to point out here is a lot of this tech we are building, as any IT professional would know, that we all write code and build technology, and we also write bugs. And that's the inevitable part, because as human beings, all of us make mistakes, right? So what typically happens is we also have something called as bug trackers, and we are held accountable to what we do, and we correct our mistakes. Now, in the process of going digital, we also need to make sure that organizations and companies and governments are held accountable in the process of going digital. So one of the simple things of having tracking accountability is having bug trackers. The next point I would like to say is Open source is necessary, but not sufficient for fair, accountable, and transparent system. So, open source systems give resource into the for anyone to inspect, but they themselves by itself it won't be a fair and accountable system. We need to put in place processes, checks, and balances in terms of legal and regulatory checks in order to have a fair and accountable system. And I'd like to briefly mention a point over here. Sharad and IndiaStack have been working on a lot of good tech, which is truly disruptive and enabling people. But it has the potential of doing the same 100 times efficiently if it's truly open, truly free and open, supports free and open source software. And Digital India needs free and open source software, at least as a player. So just like in your computer, you have the Microsoft Internet Explorer and Google Chrome, there's also open source Mozilla Firefox, right? So there could be private players, corporations, companies building businesses out of our government interactions, but it's also very important for India to have a free and open source player in all these systems. So I'll... So new age digital problems include privacy, data protection, cyber security. We need to decide whether we can trade off our rights for the cost of development. And then there is a problem of digital colonialism, algorithmic accountability, and systemic biases. The approach, the way forward, I say, is educate, increase awareness amongst students, everyone in the society about these problems, and try to figure solutions for these. I mean, as technologists, as engineers in this crowd, we need to figure out how do we solve these problems. And one of the things is cooperate with the government and see, like, if there is a bug in the app, I don't stop using the app. I won't say that this technology is broken, I won't use it. We need to go and fix it. As citizens, as much as rights we seek, there is also a duty for us to do. And with that, I will close. Thank you.
Thank you, Srikanth. He has listed out the deficiencies in the infrastructure and what has been done and what has to be done. In the banking technology, nowadays the voice-based technology has not come up much. For a country which has so much of population without literacy, voice-based technology is something probably we have to look for. Similarly, we have limitations in the security, legal infrastructure, he was saying. The infrastructure related to security is quite important. Human facts, State Bank of India had to ban 6 lakh ATM cards because of the security issue. So there are so many aspects we have to go into the digital infrastructure, which he has listed out. Thank you. Now I request Dr. Usha Ramanathan to please make her proposal.
This is a constitutional lawyer speaking to a room full of, an auditorium full of technologists. And I am going to have to start with saying that I believe that technology is a useful tool, but a very bad master. And it's from that perspective that we feel that some of us, and I know I speak for myself, but also for a set of people. So unlike others who are with institutions, and who have to put disclaimers saying that, you know, my institution doesn't think you can't, like, you know, I don't have to do that. I actually speak for a set of people who have been raising concerns. I also have this extremely useful advantage of having Mr. Sharad Sharma characterizing us. So, I mean, I think as a class, he characterized us in the last session as technologically illiterate, uninformed critics. So that kind of opens it up for me. I like it when we can speak freely. So I must return the compliment in a certain sense of saying that was saying that iSPIRT actually is one of the targets of what we are looking at, because there are specific things in the work that you do that you find particularly disturbing. And maybe it will help you to just take a look at it in terms of your technological ability, whoever. So the thing is, if you go to the iSPIRT website, you'll find that there is a narrative, a story that has been put out which they have adopted, called India in the 2030s. Now this, if this is the kind of story, it's a story of Ram and Rahim and their daughter Rani, and about how in Rani's lifetime, which is going to come in the 2030s, everything will be linked with the UID, with Aadhaar. And she doesn't have to do anything at all. She just sits there, she clicks and she gets things, and everything that we live by today is museumized. And, you know, it is all like clockwork. Everything is linked with the UID, and that they see as the panacea for all ills. And it will museumize us as we are today. Now that is a vision that I think has been contested much before we contested it by people like George Orwell. And forced therefore to bring in this concept of the Big Brother. Big brothers have always been a problem for little sisters, but in this case it is a real serious state-related problem. So I think that's one area where we completely disagree with the way in which iSPIRT looks at what these changes are that need to come in. The second thing in which we have a problem is that iSPIRT has been set up as a volunteer group. But when we look closely, we find that those who are working on India startup, people who stepped out of the UID AI, and when you look at all the documents, you find that the UID AI was expected at the beginning when it began. It's the first time when the UID AI was set up that they said that the database would be owned by the UID AI. This idea of owning our data did not exist prior to the UID project. And that put our antenna up, and we found later in 2012, completely in the midst of nothing, apropos nothing, the National Data Sharing and Accessibility Policy, which talks about the government owning our data, departments owning our data, and it's their property. So a new kind of property right is openly spoken about, which they can then share with whoever they want. Now, my data, when I give it to the government, I give it because it is a custodian of that property, and it is not an owner of my data. My data, I do not even convert into property. So, you know, this way in which the, and we found that there was a SADAP report of which Mr. Nilekani was the chair, and after that we had the GSCN that was coming, not the GST, but the GSCN. And there is much pride in saying that, you know, 5 billion invoices are going every day, you know, every month to this GSCN, and they will then be able to create algorithms through which they will be able to see remotely to the littlest person in some corner and see whether his, you know, whether his business is going up, down, and asking for a visibility of our lives, which we are not being asked whether we want to give up to them. So I think, you know, as technology people, I'm telling you that just think about it, that today people adopt technologies, they use technologies because there's a certain friendliness and an openness and a certain freedom that technology seems to give us. These are ways in which that freedom is shut down, and we are told that we are not even, forget about being, you know, the UID project said we are not concerned with whether you're a citizen or not, we are only concerned with whether you're a resident. Now they've gone one step further and they are saying, we don't care who you are, we are your subjects of the data, that's it. This is totally unacceptable. And, you know, I do the constitution. I know that we are often told by the iSPIRT people that, you know, you don't know technology. I'm, you know, inclined to tell them that they don't know the constitution then. Because there is another thing that's happened. You know, there have been strict orders from the Supreme Court saying you cannot coerce people into this. Every order has been systematically violated, and not only by the government. I think we should stop seeing this as just the government. The government has been in partnership with these people who are pushing for all of us to become data. And Mr. Nilekani, of course, has been openly talking about this, so we can quote him because he's on many of these documents which have been coming up. Again, in 2016, we've seen a number of those documents. And we've seen others too, right? You know, the Access Bank, executive director, all of them was writing, saying that banking is now going to invade our lives without our even noticing it. Now, do we really want banking to be invading our lives? And they said that they will be able to see, they will watch how we do, you know, what kind of calorie intake we have, what whether we walk properly or not, and all this will go into our credit rating trade. So when he talks about credit, I think we need to understand what that credit is and what we are supposed to give up so that at zero risk, or at least at dramatically lowered risk to the lender, they will be able to lend to us. And that's the only way in which they are going to give credit. That's the way credit is being thought of now. So it's not just about leaving a digital footprint in many places. It is also about saying that you will only get this if you agree to give your data to us. If there is one thing that we have seen in both the UID project and in demonetization, followed by cashless, it is the extent of taking away of our autonomy. Somebody comes and imposes things on us and says, if you don't do this, I don't know how you feel about this, but from my childhood, a bully always gets out the best in me. I'm sorry, Harsh, that your question didn't get answered, but this is my answer to your question on the Supreme Court's order and how you can make it mandatory. Legally, you cannot do most of the things that they are doing. And by saying that the government is doing it, so on the one hand you say government is useless, they are hopeless, on the other hand I'll use the government as much as I want and use the illegality of the government to do whatever I want. This is the kind of framework within which we are working. A couple of things more, because I think there's a lot to say, I've got pages of what there needs to be said. But other than coercion and illegality, there is this other thing called absolute disrespect for evidence. I'll just say this one thing, and then there are many other things which we can discuss in other fora. You know this biometrics, it's a classic thing. They started using biometrics for uniqueness without ever having tested it. And I'm not just saying this, I've written loads on it, you can look it up. Their documents, UIDAI documents, tell us that they had no idea about whether it would work. They said in the kind of demographics that we have, in the kind of environmental conditions that we have, we are not sure if it will work, but we have to make it work, because we decided that's going to be the unique factor. Now, on its own, okay, maybe, and they keep saying we have confidence it will work. I might even have had nothing to say particularly. I mean, yesterday I met somebody who said that they had got their UID card, the neighbor had got a UID card with a chair, you know, on in place of the photograph. So these are things that continue to happen, but you know, these are glitches, they are just aberrations. Let's see where it is not an aberration. In Goa, when there was a problem and the CBI asked the UIDAI to hand over the biometric database of the people who had enrolled in Goa, the magistrate said, yes, please give it because it will help solve a crime. Immediately, the UIDAI went running to the High Court, and the High Court too said, listen, they're not asking now for the whole database, they just want to check and see if it will help. Why would you want to stop them? And allow the CBI, it's what it wanted. They ran, UIDAI ran to the Supreme Court. In that interim, there was a news report in Business Standard which said that they were going to set up a unique UIDAI biometric center of competence. Because they were going to do research. This is 2013-14. And they said that they're going to do research to see how biometrics will work. 2014, no, March, they got an order from the Supreme Court saying, okay, you don't have to, you're using privacy. So, you know, people had gone against them in the using privacy as an example, as a reason. And the UIDAI went to the court and said, you know, privacy, and therefore we can't give anybody's biometrics to anybody else. So they didn't then have to give it. Between 2014 March and August 2015, the order of the court said that UIDAI must not give the biometrics. 2015 August 11, the court passed an order in which they said that if a court orders, the UIDAI will have to give the biometric information. The moment they did that, within 2 days we noticed, whether it was there before or not, you can check, on August 13th we noticed that on the UIDAI website, they had added one more part which said that they had set up a UBCC, that is UIDAI, Biometric Center of Competence. Why? Because they needed to check on biometrics. Why? Because the nature and diversity of India's working population makes biometrics a challenge. We know now that people who have gone to the field have come back, and I've been to the field and I've seen it too, so I can vouch for it myself, find that the poor are not able to get their rations. You know, in Rajasthan, when they say that 70% of the households at the end of the whole process are able to get their rations using their fingerprint, without which they are not being given this, I thought in the beginning that that meant that at least 70% of the people, their biometrics is working. Till I went to the field and found that actually that is not true. their biometric, one or two in a family, in a household, one or two persons, their fingerprint may work. And it's on that basis that they've been saying that 70% of the households, 30% of the households, which means for none of them it works, and that's okay. So what do we find now? There is a Vatel committee report. In the Vatel committee report and in the prior one with which iSPIRT 2 was involved, that 5 minutes, giving a loan in 5 minutes, there's a document that you'll find on the web. Now they say in that the problem that they have is that the RBI accepts eKYC only with biometrics, with fingerprints. And they say, no, that won't work for us. We want to have a two-factor authentication which will not include biometrics for our work. So when you want to set up fintech companies and you want to make money on it, you don't want the biometric to become an obstacle. But when it is happening in TDS, let the poor die. So this callousness, and the last thing I want to say is that this cashless is not just cashless. And this too is iSPIRT and IndiaStack inspired. It's all over the web. You can go to YouTube and see it. They say that it will be cashless, paperless, and presenceless. E-sign, e-KYC with DigiLocker, with a consent architecture, which, like Mr. Sharma admitted to us a while ago, has not yet been prepared. In the earlier sessions, he admitted that it hasn't yet been prepared. It's in the process of being prepared. So consent architecture, this, that, all that can wait. We will just go ahead with this and we get what we want, because when you say it's cashless, it's one kind of control and autonomy that's being taken. When you say it's paperless, like all RPI people tell us, where there is no paper, what is Mr. Ruchit Patel saying today? He's saying, yeah, we had this discussion then, but we didn't keep any minutes. We don't have any paper. So this is one way by which you can't get anybody anywhere at all, not even your own accounts. And they will digitally tell you and maintain it. So you're no longer even the subjects of this exercise, you're just objects of this exercise. I'm not sure that this kind of change is the kind, when people say 70 years we've carried on like this and nothing else has happened, that's rubbish. In 70 years we've changed an enormous amount. We are not where we were 70 years ago. So to make it appear like this, some set of handled, whatever people, have come in and now they are bringing revolution into our lives, that is not true. We have dramatically changed in all these years. You ask anybody from families who were nowhere in the 1940s, and you ask them where they are today. It's not for you and me. Maybe many people here too have seen generations where you progress way beyond where you were in the beginning. So this, as emotional appeal, I think it's always interesting to have an emotional appeal, but it's not rational appeal, and I don't think we can agree with that. So I'll just stop with that, but just to say this, that we are all technology-related people. I don't use a mobile phone, so I'm told that, you're a Luddite. But I don't use email. I do use other people's email, mobile phones when I find it convenient. I use it when it is convenient for me. What the government and those who are pushing these kind of projects through the government, in partnership with the government, are telling us, and this is what Demonetisation 2 has done. What they are telling us is, who gives you a choice? Get onto a system. And remember that neither the UIDAI nor many of the other things that they are bringing in will have, the UIDAI certainly doesn't have, an opt-out provision. You can opt in, but you can't get out. It's like being in a, being given, as a lawyer, I do a lot of work in criminal law, it's like having a permanent life sentence from which you can never get out. Even the criminal law doesn't require you to be inside prison all your life. And I cannot understand how anybody who values technology, and many of us value technology, we just don't value this method of dealing with technology, how anyone who values technology can think that creating a prison through the use of technology can be a good idea. Just one last word I want to say. And this last word is this. That when demonetization came in, we kept hearing about people who were standing in queues and who died, some other people who died in other places. As a constitutional lawyer, I know that the right to life is fundamental. It's the job of a government to make sure that they preserve and protect the right to life. And when this is treated as a minor inconvenience, the loss of life, I think we've really reached a very, very low level in terms of our public and political understanding of who we are and who we allow other people to become. just end with respect for those people and for a moment of thought for those people who died in this process and who are now being treated as collateral damage.
Thank you very much, Dr. Usha. Due to paucity of time, the organizers have said that there will not be questions. Later on, you can interact with the resource person. I would like to just end this session with two points. One, we are all welcoming technology. I am part of the Technology Vision 2035 document produced by the Government of India, which we have been organizing seminar. But what type of technology is needed and for the benefit of whom is something important. Today, the US President is giving a speech saying that we Americans, and today he is saying that why Americans? Whereas we are dependent on all this technology even today related to banking alone, let me tell you. The POS machines which we use, Verifone and Ingenico, manufactured from China, supplied by Worldwide and Hitachi. Every ATM card which we are using, Visa card or MasterCard or Amex, we are paying 48 pence per transaction to that company. All multinational foreign companies. So, we have to look for technology which will suit our country, and also we have to find alternatives for these technologies which have been imported to this country. Secondly, we have seen the massive uprise of youth in Chennai, throughout Tamil Nadu, and majority here are youth. A big hope has come that there will be a change. It was not just a delegate, much more than that. So big change is going to come. So you have to decide what kind of change is needed. Dr. Usha was talking about the life of people. Today in our state, in three districts, more than 100 farmers have died. Why? Because in spite of all this talking about Mudra loan, Startup India loan, agriculture loan, banks are not lending to the small farmers. They are dependent, as Mr. Sharma was saying, they are dependent on the money lenders. When are we going to change the policies? The change in policies to benefit the larger majority is what is needed. Thank you, Mona.
This is the end of the second plenary session, and I would like to extend our gratitude to all the speakers on stage who were all involved in such an extensive and healthy debate. And I would like to thank Mr. Thomas Franco, Dr. Usha Ramanathan, Sharad Sharma, Srikanth, Lakshmanan, Dr. Madhava Rao. Thank you all of you.